to be living in this time of the earth's history. The disciples asked Jesus a million-dollar question: what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? So this morning, we'd like to look at Jesus' answer to them. What shall be the sign? And take note, there is no S. So there's something that encompasses all the signs that shows us that we are at the end of time. Join with me as we open up with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise, dear Lord, where we can open up your word as your children, as brothers and sisters, to see what you have to say to us this morning. Father, we're not living in ordinary times. We're living at the end. And like the disciples, dear Lord, we ask the same question: what shall be the sign of your coming and of the end of the world? So, dear Heavenly Father, I pray that you enlighten our minds this morning, draw us closer to you, and help us to be prepared and ready for your soon return. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. When I was traveling about almost 2 weeks ago, and I got to, when I was at the airport, and I saw everyone wearing a face mask. Sometimes out here in this part of Missouri where we do not wear the face mask, sometimes we forget that there's a world out there that is doing something a little totally different. And the question came to my mind: how did we get here? How did we get to this point where we're being so controlled? We're being so terrorized? And that's a question that was lingering on my mind. And even in the answer that Jesus gave to the disciples, that question is answered. How did we get here? And the disciples, more specifically, Peter, James, John, and Andrew, the Bible says in the book of Mark, they came to him privately and asked him, what shall be the sign of thy coming? And I can see this applies to us. We ought to go to Christ privately asking him, what shall be the sign of your coming and of the end of the world? So what was Jesus' answer? He said, and Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. Isn't that a simple answer? But he said, take heed. That word heed means to perceive, to see, to discern, have understanding. It's like a warning. But there's only one way we can discern. And let us go to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And verse 14. And it reads, 1 Corinthians 2:14. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. Mm-hmm. In order to understand the end time events, it has to be spiritually discerned. And we have to have a connection with the Lord. If we have His Spirit, then He will reveal to us the time, where we are, and what we are to do. But Jesus told them, take heed that no man deceive you. In the end times in which we are living in, the key will be deception. Satan is working feverishly, trying to deceive the whole world. Mm-hmm. And we'll look at the text that Jesus goes down, because Jesus, He's a masterful teacher. He gave an answer. This is a sign that we're in the end of time. Deception. And then he began to expound upon it. Explain it even more. So we continue. Now, we're in a great controversy. It's a great controversy between Christ and Satan, between truth and error, truth and deception. This is why deception is one of the key signs. Truth is going to come to its maximum. It's going to come to 100%. Truth will be fully developed.
Amen.
But guess what will be developed as well?
Right.
Deception, error, evil, lies. This is why Jesus said, take heed that no man deceive you. Because a sign that we're in the end of time is the fact that evil, deception, lies are coming to its full maximum.
Mm-hmm.
Because the Bible also said that many are called, but few are chosen. So in reality, more people at the end, this is not what God wants, but this is what happens, would be siding with, aligned with evil. More people will become part of the deception. But God wants us to be aligned with him, because the Bible says in John 14 and verse 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus is the truth. Satan is a liar. Let's go to the book of Isaiah, chapter 14. Isaiah chapter 14. And we read verses 12 to 15. Because the disciples asked him, what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end? The end tells us that there is a limit. There's a limit where the Lord said, this and go, we go no further. So let's see what happened with Satan, as the Bible tells us here in Isaiah 14, verses 12 through 15. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. Satan wants to be what? He wants to be God.
Mm-hmm.
He wants worship. He said, I will be like the Most High. I will ascend my throne. So in the end time, Satan, he's trying to do just that. He wants to be God. You realize that the deceptions that are happening in these last days, Satan working through humans, working through people, are trying to take the place of God.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of deception, and it goes back to this verse, these texts that we just read. Satan himself wants to be God. Now, Paul explains the same thing that Christ tells us in 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 1, which reads, this know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. Do we know what the word perilous means?
Dangerous,
hard to bear, troublesome, harsh, fierce, savage. We have come to that time.
Mm.
What makes it dangerous too is error is being counted as truth, and truth is being counted as error. And Paul goes on to say in verse 13, but evil men and seducers shall wax up worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. I looked up that word seducers. It means a deceiver and imposter. Evil men and seducers will wax worse and worse, not better. But they are deceiving, and they're being deceived. Are we seeing a lot of deception coming from those that are supposed to be leading us?
Yeah.
Yes. And the interesting thing is, not only are they deceiving, but according to the text, what's happening as well?
Deceiving others.
Being deceived.
They're being deceived. You see, when we understand there's a pyramid, Satan himself is at the top of the pyramid. And who's right below him?
Minion.
The Pope.
I mean,
Papacy
is right below him. Minion. And then everyone else falls below. But he's at the top. So When it was in the Air Force, they would tell us that there is a need to know. You only know according to your rank and what you need to know to perform your job. And it's the same thing. Those at the lower level of the pyramid, they're deceiving those below them. But at the same time, they're being deceived.
Mm-hmm.
God does not want us to be deceived. The Bible tells us of Satan in Genesis 3 and verse 1. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And then I like to look up the words. In these last days, God gave us a way how to study the Bible. And then go to the concordance. So I want to know what the word subtle means. And the Bible in the concordance, it said it means shrewd, crafty, sly, cunning. This is what the devil is saying. Then I looked up in the dictionary cunning. And it means having or showing skill in achieving one's ends by deceit or evasion.
Mm.
If we understand the time and we see the events, we realize that there's a lot of deceit and a lot of evasion. Now, it's all because Satan wants to be God. He wants worship. He has individuals in high places that is working for him. The text goes on to say, and he said unto the woman, yea, had God said ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? Satan is just, he's so deceptive. Let's go to Genesis chapter 2 and read what God said. And look with Satan this deceive his deceit, how he twisted. He mixed truth and error.
Mm-hmm.
Genesis 2, 16 and 17. And in this verse, God is declaring to us the end from the beginning. In the beginning, the enemy was deceitful. In the end, he is deceitful. But he's coming to his peak. As time goes on, we see more and more deception. Now, Genesis 2, verse 16 and 17. And the Lord commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it. For in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. Do we catch the difference between what God said and what Satan said? God said, you shall eat of every tree of the garden except this one.
Mm-hmm.
But when the enemy said it, he said, did God say you cannot eat of every tree?
Mm-hmm.
Do you see how he put it in a bad line? He twisted it?
Mm-hmm.
Deception, cunning. So the enemy can use truth and error to deceive us. Speaking of the devil, John 8 and verse 44 says, he was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. So those who associated with him, they'll be liars as well, deceitful as well. He is the father of lies. Matthew 24 and verse 6, as Jesus answers the question, what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. Remember, these are all under the heading or the covering of deception. So you may be saying, Brother Saunders, what are you saying? There won't be any wars or any rumors of wars? Yes, there will be wars and rumors of wars. For those of us that are old enough, we remember back in 1991, they said that Saddam Hussein had weapons of mass destruction, and there was a big Gulf War. How much weapons of mass destruction was found?
None.
Zero. Deception. But there was an agenda. It's all about the agenda. You see, is that what God wants us just to know, that they're deceived? He does not want us to be caught up
mm-hmm.
in the agendas.
Mm-hmm.
Because the enemy is trying to put us to a certain angle so he can get his objectives accomplished.
That's right.
But we should not be used as a means for him to accomplish his dirty deeds.
Amen.
So God is alerting us that there will be a lot of deceit. Now, I look up that word troubled. It means frightened, to be be troubled in mind, to be frightened, alarmed. God said, don't be alarmed. Don't be terrified. Don't be scared. These things will happen. These are all the deceits of the enemy. You see, the Bible tells us in Isaiah, in Jeremiah 29, verse 11, he said, I know the thought that I think toward you. He said, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. Do you know Satan have a plan for us too? He have a thought toward each and every one of us, and he wants to bring us toward an expected end. So he has a plan. Now, many of us probably have seen this week. This is a beast that is placed outside of the UN headquarters.
Wow.
in New York City. And this beast, it looks a lot like the beast in Revelation and in the book of Daniel. And you see, these folks, the New World Order, they have a thing that is hidden in plain sight. And this was just recently placed there. This is saying a lot. Now, this is the purpose they said it is for. It is the guardians of peace.
Wow.
And this beast says a lot. You know, if you study Revelation 13, and you study Daniel 7, 8, 9, and so forth, there's beasts with wings and a mouth as a lion and feet as a bear and body as a leopard. You see, this image, it encompasses all these signs. And they're actually telling you what is coming. Really, the mark of the beast is heading, it's coming. They're telling you what they're about to do. Guardian of peace. But what does the Bible tell us?
Peace and safety.
The Bible says, for when they shall say what?
Peace
and safety. Then sudden destruction cometh upon them, as travail upon a woman with child. And the Bible says, and they shall not escape. You see, this text, it has twofold meaning. Yes, God is going to deal with them. But also, it's also telling you how they speak. When they say peace, what do they really mean?
Destruction.
They speak in opposite terms. Mm-hmm. When they tell you this is good for you, take it. It means it's going to kill you. God wants us to know there is deception. You know, I remember just a few years ago, when I heard certain things, and you may be sitting in the same position today. Like I heard of harp. When I heard of harp, I said, that is conspiracy theory. Mm. But that's H-A-R-P.
Mm-hmm.
The way they tamper with the weather and different things. But guess what? It's real. And as Christians, if someone tells you these things out there, then you can say it's conspiracy. But when you read it in the Bible or in the spirit of prophecy, guess what? It's real.
Mm-hmm.
It's real. Now, the U.S. warns Russia over Ukraine as fear of war rise. Remember the Bible says, wars and rumors of wars. Why rumors of wars? I don't understand war.
Fear.
You see, the New World Order, the powers that be, they have an agenda. In order to accomplish their agendas, the people have the power. They must get us into a certain mindset. Fearful. Mm. We must be tormented. And then they can bring about their agenda. Mm. Don't take these things thinking that it's conspiracy. These are true. If they get us into a certain mindset, then they can change the rules.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll actually ask them to do it. We'll tell them, hey, change this. Take away my security. Take away my freedom. I'm afraid.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we do. Satan delights in war. For it excites the worst passions of the soul and then sweeps into eternity its victims, steeped in vice and blood.
Yeah.
It is his object to incite the nations to war against one another, for he can thus divert the minds of the people from the work of preparation to stand in the day of God.
Wow.
So we see the reason for him with these wars and the rumors of wars. He wants to take out people in the sin, but also he divert our minds.
Mm-hmm.
So if we are deceived and we are caught up, oh, Russia is so bad, China is so bad, then we're not getting ready to prepare for the coming of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
You see? So we cannot be caught up in propaganda. We cannot be caught up in the new world order agenda. There is an agenda, and we better believe it.
Mm-hmm.
For nation shall rise against nation. A few weeks ago, when we had the health seminar, the guy that did the presentation, he mentioned nations. And he said it's not only related to countries. So what I do, or what we should all do, when we hear something, we research it. So I went to the concordance, and I looked up the word nation. Because it makes sense. A little further down, it says kingdom against kingdom. If the nation means a country, then what does kingdom against kingdom mean? Because we know kingdom in the Bible means a country, a nation. Mm-hmm. So let's see. In the concordance, it means a multitude associated or living together. A multitude of individuals of the same nature or genus. Now, ethnos. What do you think is the root word of ethnos?
People?
Ethnic.
So I look up ethnic in the dictionary. It says, of or related to a large group of people classed according to common racial, national, tribal, religious, linguistic, or cultural origin or background. So if you go back to the quote, the Bible says, nation against nation, what is it referring to?
People.
Groups. Ethnic groups.
One group against another. Have we been seeing a lot of tension between groups?
Mm-hmm.
Between blacks and whites, mm-hmm. Hispanics and everyone else, and just, it's like, these are the work of the enemy. The enemy has done this because he has an agenda. Because what does the Bible tell us in Matthew 12, verse 25? And again, as God's people, we cannot be caught up in these things.
Mm-hmm.
It's not about blacks and whites and Hispanics and nothing like that.
Mm-mm.
Satan is using these things. He's deceiving us to divide. Because when he divides, according to Matthew 12 and verse 25, what does the Bible say? Matthew 12 and verse 25.
Can't stand.
Right. The Bible says here, and Jesus knew their thoughts and said unto them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to what? Desolation. And every city or house divided against itself shall not stand. We have to understand prophecy. You see, the United States plays a very important role in prophecy. God opened up the doors of this nation to house his people, and the enemy knows it. And if you want to bring the world down, you have to bring down the country that has God's people, the headquarters of his church in it.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
These are part of the deception of the enemy.
Mm-hmm.
Nations against nations. And there shall be famines. And this famine, yes, there's going to be famine. I hope that we're growing and canning.
Mm-hmm.
Because there will be famine. There will be trouble. But it encompasses more than this. We remember the story of Joseph in Egypt. There was a famine. And the Bible says that eventually the money failed. All money is about to fail.
Mm-hmm.
You see, there's a lot of deception, as Jesus told us. When I look at what's happening in the world, the powers that be are actually removing the nuts and the bolts and the screws and letting everything fall apart.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's being blamed on something else. The Bible says that there shall be famine. Amos, let's go to the book of Amos, chapter 8 and verse 11. We have it?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Behold, the days come, said the Lord God, that I will send a famine in the land, not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
So we see that God said there will be a famine, not for food or water, but for the word. Likewise, the famine that is coming is not limited to food alone.
Mm-hmm.
And we can all already see some of these things. Look at this quote I got from the economic collapse. In the last year, the price of a used car, for example, went up by more than 30%. Beef prices have risen by 21%. Crude oil up 55%. Dimensional lumber up by 35%. Wheat 37%. Sugar 33%. Corn 39%. Palm oil 43%. The price of coffee has risen 108% in the last year. Do you like breakfast cereal? Oh, sorry. Oats are up 115%. Now, this is only in 1 year. Can we get a little picture of what's happening? Where are we heading? Do we catch it? Famine is coming. Many of us don't grow anyway, so as these things grow up, we'll be in trouble. Even if plants are growing, God wants us to be ready. Inflation is out of control. And here is another part of the deception. What is it to do? It's time for the Fed to raise interest rates. And these are some of the things that are causing the problems in the first place, right? But workers in Europe are demanding higher pay as the inflation soars. We are heading for trouble. We are heading for trouble. Bible tells us in Revelation 13 and verse 17, and that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. This is where we're heading, and we're heading there fast. You know, the thing that God has asked us to do, it is time for us to do it. We cannot linger anymore any longer. It's moving, prophecies are moving pretty fast. Mm-hmm. What about pestilences? Mm-hmm. Is there any pestilence amongst us today? Mm-hmm. Yeah. You see, all these are part of Satan's deception. Many people believe that the coronavirus came from a lab. Do they have reason to believe this? Mm-hmm. Why don't people trust their governments anymore? Mm-hmm. You see, God is actually allowing us. For those that have a measure of connection with him, he's given us the spirit of discernment so we can know that something is wrong. Mm-hmm. Something is not right. COVID-19 vaccine distrust. Why it's high and how to respond to it. Now, if you probably read an article from this lady here, she bungles your mind, part of the deception. She tells you how to deal with these people distrusting the vaccine, mm-hmm. how to get them to take it. All you have to do is, if it's good, just show it to them, prove it, and they'll take it. But if you have to bamboozle their minds or deceive them, then it's no good. Mm-hmm. But it's all part of the deception. CDC director reverses course, now open to change the definition of fully vaccinated. Oh, no. And then after you take the first, you needed one dose, then two, then three, then four, then five, then when does it end? Mm. Because it's part of a deception. Mm-hmm. God wants us to be intelligent. We cannot hide from these things. You know, I realize there's three categories of us of God's people. There are those of us that pay too much attention to these things, and we need to be careful of that. And then there are those of us that push it under the rug and leave it alone. We don't even pay attention to it. It's going to go away. That's not good either. But there should be us who know what is happening and make the necessary adjustment. Don't pay too much attention to this. Don't live on it. Mm-hmm. Because the Bible says, by beholding, what would happen?
You become changed.
And I've seen it. I've seen it among some brethren. We have behold these things so much. We follow these things that we more caught up in afraid than preparing for the Lord's return. Mm-hmm. So if we got to be prepared. Amen. The Bible says, O Timothy, keep that which is committed to thy trust. Avoid profane and vain babblings and opposition of science, falsely so called. So this thing that people call science that is not true science. Mm-hmm. Didn't we just read the CDC director? She said they're going to change the definition of fully vaccinated. No, they're about to change the definition of science.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The spirit of prophecy says, in this generation, which one?
This
generation. There are many whose eyes become dazzled by the glare of human speculation, science, falsely so-called. They discern not the net and walk into it as readily as blinds folded. Mm. So there's a false science in this last generation. I love the Bible. I love the spirit of prophecy.
Amen.
The Lord said, I'm telling these things before they come to pass, so that when they come to pass, you may believe. Thus, look what the false science will do. Thus, the false science of the present day, which undermines faith in the Bible, will prove as successful in preparing the way for the acceptance of the papacy. The false science that they're using.
Mm-hmm.
You see, God has blessed us as a people. He has given us a more sure word of prophecy.
Amen.
We've been teaching for years that, you know, a son of the law is coming. The mark of the beast is coming. And we are seeing it. The false signs that we are seeing is going to pave the way for the return of the papacy.
Mm-hmm.
And I've said it. Also in the text, Matthew 24 and verse 7, it talks about earthquakes. And there shall be earthquakes in diverse places. Again, I went to the concordance of one of my friends. Now, what's an earthquake according to the concordance? It's a shaking, a commotion, a tempest, an earthquake. A commotion that is of the air, a gale of the ground, an earthquake. So based on this definition, what the Bible said, there shall be earthquake in diverse places. What's one word for that?
Mm-hmm.
Well, what's the word you can use for that based on the concordant definition?
In different places.
Natural disasters.
Mm-hmm.
It's not limited to a shaking. A tempest is a storm. It tells you air, commotion that is of the air, gale of the ground. It's natural disasters. Now, is there a lot of talk of disasters, natural disasters lately?
Oh, yeah.
What is it called? What's the key word today?
Climate change.
Very good. Climate change.
Mm-hmm.
You see, but the Lord, remember, this falls under what?
Mm-hmm.
Deception. You see, what we have to understand, sometimes people say things, and we need to, you know, like it was said that there is no climate change. But really, these are keys for us to think. Something is happening.
Mm-hmm.
What's the source?
Mm-hmm.
Where is it coming from? Why did we have all these tornadoes and all these different things at this time of the year?
Mm-hmm.
There are people that are manipulating things.
Mm-hmm.
And it may sound far-fetched, but it is true. Climate change. And again, God doesn't want us as his people to be, if you want to help the environment, do it in your own area,
mm-hmm.
in your circle of influence. You cut a tree, you replant the tree.
Mm-hmm.
You grow, you know, green and be good to the environment. But don't be caught up with this climate change movement.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's an agenda. The New World Order. Widespread damaging, unusual December storms, sparks, derecho, tornadoes in the plains, Midwest. We had some pretty good weather in terms of temperature lately. And it's not typical for this time of the year, right?
Mm-hmm.
But we saw the result. There was tornadoes that took out, it did some damaging. When I looked at some of those pictures, I said, my goodness.
Oh.
But you see, remember the Bible says, evil men and seducers will wax worse and worse.
Mm-hmm.
Evil men. They'll wipe out this whole church if it's necessary to gain their agenda.
Mm-hmm.
Historic wind storm slams central U.S. unleashes rare December tornadoes.
Mm-hmm.
Rare. Something is happening. And the Bible tells us in Matthew 24 and verse 8, all these are the beginning of sorrows. Do we know what the word sorrows means?
Mm.
Let's let the concordance help us. The pain of childbirth. Number two, intolerable anguish in reference to the dire calamities precede the advent of the Messiah.
Mm.
All these things that we are seeing is the beginning of sorrows. There'll be more. It's gonna get worse and worse until Jesus comes. But remember, it's part of a deception. Satan is working through his agents to accomplish his will. And you can, we can turn our heads against it or mind and say that is not so, because I thought so too. But the more you study and the more you see it, this is what's happening.
Mm-hmm.
But look what all of this is leading up to. The Bible says, then, after all these deceptions, then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. Mm. Do we know what event this is referring to?
Sunday law.
Sunday law. And how does Chris know this? You see that we said, for my name's sake, right? Mm-hmm. In the Sabbath commandment, the fourth commandment, it says that, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In the fourth commandment, you'll find the name of the Lord. Mm. So you'll be hated of all nations for my name's sake. Mm. The Sabbath, and the also name represents character,
mm-hmm.
for God's character. And the, this is why we read in Revelation 14 and verse 1, and I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his father's name written in their foreheads. And Revelation 22, verse 4, and they shall see his face, and his name shall be in their foreheads.
Yeah.
His character, they'll be like him. You see, the Sabbath, that's another study we'll do. The Sabbath is very important. It's more than just a day. It represents that the work is finished in God. You see, that is why, because of the Sabbath, it's not just a day. The Sabbath means, if you're keeping the Sabbath, it means that God is working upon you to recreate his image in you.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't want to see the Father's name written in your forehead, because he wants to take us with him.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there's something called, no, we look at the Bible. The Bible showed us. And now the world tells about Hegelian dialectic,
mm-hmm.
you know, and it's don't try to fully understand this thing, because it's losing your mind. But more or less, they have an agenda, and in the New World Order's case, it's centralizing our power. Now, they have a thesis,
uh-huh.
and to get it, they terror events. Some are fake, some are real. Mm-hmm. Even some of the things that we're going to see in the end times, some are created, some are real, you know. Then they have an anti-thesis. Increased police state, removal of freedoms, transfer of power. Are we losing some of our freedoms?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And you know it's worldwide. Thank God for the United States. Do you know in places like Austria and Australia and different parts of the world, I wouldn't want to live there right now.
Wow.
It's just crazy. And that is why the Bible says that it is when the Sunday law is passed in the United States that it becomes the mark of the beast.
Mm-hmm.
Those other countries, they're already.
Mm-hmm.
But thank God for the Constitution. But guess what? Is being knocked away, slowly but surely. There's a lot of things going on, but now this is what's happening in we'll put it in a spiritual way. Satan wants to be like the Most High. So he creates crisis, fake or real, but it's to be seen, right? He brings fear, torment, and then a one world religion, Sunday worship, Satan gets his worship.
Mm-hmm.
So that is why God doesn't want us to become faithful. He wants us to understand what is taking place. Now, for the next few minutes, we also see that the spirit of prophecy says exactly what we just read.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll find out that whatever the Bible says, the same principle is in the spirit of prophecy and vice versa. When I'm studying, I like to go to the Bible and I study. And then sometimes, and then the pioneers did this. They studied the Bible, and they got to a point that they couldn't go any further. And guess where they turned to?
Mm-hmm.
The prophet. So you study the Bible, and then you go to the spirit of prophecy. And what's nice and sweet, when you study something in the Bible, and then the spirit of prophecy says the same thing. That's just beautiful.
Mm.
Satan works through the elements also to garner his harvest of unprepared souls.
Mm.
He has studied the secrets of the laboratories of nature. And he uses his power to control the elements as far as God allows.
Mm.
So you see the spirit of prophecy, you see it's not conspiracy. Mm. She's saying it even more plainly.
Mm.
He went, what's a laboratory? We've been in school and we had our labs, right? And we
chemistry
experiment
lab.
And we put stuff together, and you know. He has his lab. But guess what? In Matthew, I'm gonna read it for time's sake, Matthew 16:23. But he turned and said unto Peter, get thee behind me, Satan. Who was God? Who was Jesus speaking to?
Peter.
What did he call Peter?
Satan.
Satan. So when this quote says Satan works, could this also refer to human beings, people?
Oh, yeah.
Yes. He has his agents. What appearing to the children of men as a great physician who can heal all their maladies, he will bring disease and disaster until populous cities are reduced to ruin and desolation. Mm. I mean, it's plain. Mm. We have seen this thing happen before us. This is what the enemy wants to do. He's appearing as a great physician. Yes, I have this wonderful drug for you. This wonderful vaccine or whatever he may have, because this is, the Bible says, pestilences. So what does that tell us?
More than one.
And someone told me that, I think that it was mentioned that there's more coming, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. They're telling you before it comes. Even now, he's at work in accidents and calamities by sea and by land, in great conflagrations, in fierce tornadoes like what we had, and terrific hailstorms, in tempests, floods, cyclones. And I understand there's a cyclone, a hurricane that hit the Philippines. And it went quickly from a category 1 or 2 or something to a category 5.
Wow.
Tidal waves and earthquakes in every place and in 1,000 forms. Satan is exercising his power.
Mm.
God is letting us know. He sweeps away the ripening harvest, and famine and distress follows. He imparts to the air a deadly taint, and 1,000 perish by the pestilence. These visitations are to become more and more frequent and disastrous. Destruction will be upon man and beast.
Mm-hmm.
Satan working through his agent, evil. What they're doing is evil.
Mm.
That is what God wants us to cling to him and not to be caught up in the deception. And the great deceiver will persuade men that those who serve God are causing these evils.
Mm.
The class that have provoked the displeasure of heaven will charge all their troubles upon those whose obedience to God's commandment is a perpetual reproof to transgressors.
Mm-hmm.
So you see how it's turning, the disasters, the pestilences, the earthquakes, everything. And then, I when I was coming back, I stopped in Atlanta before the plane came over here. And I pulled up a news app, but I have on my phone. Usually it's for this local area, but it gets the news from the area that you're in. So while I was there in Atlanta, a story came up from Atlanta, and there was a lady, and they use the term partner. I didn't read the whole story. Sometimes when they say partner, then some flags goes up, but it was saying that she took a taxi, she and her partner, and when they were on the freeway, the Uber driver, not the Uber driver, Uber asked her if they're vaccinated, and they said no. And he stopped in the middle of the freeway and let them out.
Oh.
Yes. So, you'll be blamed for all the problems
mm-hmm.
if you don't, go along with the agenda.
Mm-hmm.
It will be declared that men are offending God by the violation of the Sunday Sabbath, that this sin has brought calamities which will not cease until Sunday observance shall be strictly enforced, and that those who present the claim of the fourth commandment, thus destroying reverence for Sunday, are troublers of the people, preventing their restoration to divine favor and temporal prosperity.
Mm.
Now, it's amazing because right now they're telling you, you guys are the ones that causing all these diseases. We can get rid of, we can go back to normal if you will just conform.
Mm-hmm.
And you see the same wording.
Mm-hmm.
You want to go back to, but let me say this. Things will never go back to normal again.
Mm-hmm.
It will never go back to normal. So we ought to actually be preparing for heaven, for the heavenly kingdom. The Bible tells us we are not to put our trust in princes. Matthew 24, verse 4, we read this before. And Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no man deceive you. We have to take heed. We need spiritual discernment. We need wisdom from above.
Amen.
We cannot do this on our own. There's many more deceptions to come,
mm-hmm.
and they will continue. And this is the only way we can not be deceived. The Bible says in John 8:32, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free.
Amen.
And Jesus is the truth. And in order to know truth, what must you study? Truth or error?
Truth.
Truth. Because if you, that is why I made the statement a little earlier. We are not to focus so much on and even what the papacy is doing, because then we'll become changed.
That's right.
Remember, he has power.
Mm.
He does. Through satanic powers.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Ye shall know them by their fruits. Do not men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles? Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. These texts God has given us, they can be used in so many ways. When we look at climate change, when we look at the pestilence and the COVID response, is it bringing good or is it bringing evil?
Evil.
It's bringing evil. So you know by the fruit where it's coming from. You don't have to be a rocket scientist, but you need spiritual eyesight, right?
Mm. Amen.
A corrupt tree bringeth forth corrupt fruit. Economies are being destroyed, lives are being destroyed, people are being separated. I go to St. Croix and I see some of my friends and I cannot embrace them.
Mm.
They have a ad on the radio that says, remember, no hug, no touching, no kissing.
Oh,
and all this is to avoid. The Bible says in the last days that
the love of many will wax cold.
Because we are so, I don't want to touch you, I don't want to go close to you. Mm. Let's stay 6 feet apart.
Mm.
The love of many shall wax cold, and that is why someone can now take a gun and go and shoot the brother down, because the love has gone.
Mm-hmm.
You know? A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. Wherefore, by their fruits, ye shall know them.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have to guess. We can tell and we can see. We are living in some really interesting times. God is not the author of confusion, but of peace.
Mm-hmm.
That's 1 Corinthians 14:33. I am convinced with all my heart we have come to the end of time.
Mm-hmm.
And I also believe we are hearing some of the last messages. And it's not because I'm saying it, but I'm saying because of the time, we have come to a time when many will be deceived. The Bible says, if it was possible, Satan will do what? Deceive the very elect. So he's going to come real good, but we must have a connection, a relationship with the Lord, or else we will be deceived.
Mm-hmm.
God is calling us to be ready. It is very late in the game. You know, and as we finish, when every day I see so many prophecies that are being fulfilled, mm-hmm. I can't keep up. There's a lot. And what I realize too, as time goes closer to the end, things are becoming more clearer. Prophecies are becoming more clearer. Many people would say, well, we always had wars and we had famines and we had these things, but guess what? You have to now look at it in light of deception. Satan is going to use them to prove or to claim that he is God. Because guess what? After all this is said and done, he's going to come as a healer. He's going to come as the person that has the solution.
Mm-hmm.
But guess what? He brought the problems.
Mm-hmm.
So God wants us to be wise.
Amen.
So let us pray. Let's be forward of prayer. The Heavenly Father and our God, we have reached a very interesting time in this earth's history. Father, never have we been here before. So Heavenly Father, we need wisdom. We need understanding. So that we may be able to go through the trouble with wisdom and understanding and not be deceived. Father, we do not want to be on the side of the enemy, on the side of the New World Order. We want to be on your side. So this afternoon, dear Lord, we ask that you strengthen us, that you give us the wisdom, the knowledge, the know-how to walk and follow you for the Slovenia Court.